So,
who is this guy? Well, I'm Andy. I've got a bachelor's degree in math from the University of Florida. I very often say, wow, what's your degree? And I say, journalism. And they're like, no. And I'm like, yes. No, I'm just kidding. It's math. I was the captain of the math team in high school. I used to wear glasses, didn't have a beard, so I was very friendless and very had my virginity strong and intact. I will tell bad jokes, and when they're bad, they're gonna throw candy at you to make up for it. So we're gonna have a good time. My usual shtick, I used to do this in Gainesville, Florida, I would have a handle of whiskey, and every time I made a mistake, and you guys caught me, I would have to take a shot. Those are the rules of the game. And we're not doing that today, because I don't want to scare anyone off, but maybe for the final exam review, I'll have a handle right next to me, and we're ready to go, okay? Alright, so how do you guys get the most out of this review? Be attentive to what's being written, as well as what's being said. It's not enough to just write everything down, you've got to also key in what I'm saying as well, so try and be aware of all that. Ask a question the moment that I lose you. It's not good enough to ask 5 minutes later, because if I've lost you 5 minutes ago, then you have to relearn all the 5 minute things I said the last 5 minutes. So stop me anytime. You say, hey, Andy, what the hell did you say? You lost me. So stop me anytime. Just throw your hand up. It's fine. And if you're not asking me questions here, you're making a huge mistake. You're going to have a bad time. Okay? Refrain from talking and texting too much. I know it's tempting to do, but guess what? If you're texting and talking too much, then what happens is I lose you, and then I have to ask a question, and then we go through this vicious cycle. So, how do you succeed beyond the review? Attend all the Easy A calculus reviews before every exam for this class. Each review explains all the things you just slept through in class or just didn't go to class for. Tackle the huge practice set at the end of each packet. There are about 50, maybe 50 even problems at the very back of this packet, for which I will have video solutions posted. Actually, the first 30 already have video solutions posted or will be posted. The link to the website, you go there and then go look at the video solutions. All of those solutions will be there, and then I have to record the next 20, but good 50 set of 50 practice problems to look at. If you learn nothing else from me, doing a little bit of math every day will make you a little bit better at calculus, and you only get better by doing, okay? Practice makes perfect. I know it sounds oversaid and trite, and but practice does make perfect in this case. Even if you only do calculus for 30 minutes every day, it helps you out quite a bit. And then lastly, if you feel like you can't make the reviews or the reviews aren't grooving really well with your exam schedule, of course I have to try to accommodate all the different sections of calculus. Some people have their exam a few weeks from now. Some people have already had their exam, so I feel bad for those people who didn't get to come see me. But if for whatever reason, the exam 2 review is, let's say, October 31st, right on Halloween, what a terrible professor that would be. Then my review is on October, or my review is in November, then guess what? You missed it. Or maybe my next review is on October 15th. That's obviously really far ahead. So if it doesn't work too well for you, you can always go to Easy A Calculus. Grab a packet, guys. You can always go to easyacalculus.com and then book me as a private tutor. The rates are different for if you're just by yourself versus if you're a group. So if you've got two people together, that counts as a group. So the rate is really, really nice. It's like $20 for 2 hours per person if you form a group. Now, whether that's a group can be two people or 20 people, okay? All right, skip ahead to our warm-up. So we're going to go ahead and warm up with some questions that are, these are the kind of things that are going to get you ready to run through some pre-calculus, kind of stretch our brain muscle here. Okay, solve or evaluate. So we have log base 8 of 2 plus log base 8 of 32. When you add two logs of the same base, what do you do with their arguments? Multiply. So this is going to become log base 8 of 2 times 32, or log base 8 of 64. Some of you are like, I know this already. That's cool. But some people are like, I need this. This is good for me. It's like nutrients. It's like vegetables. Log base 8 of 64. That would be 2. What power do I raise 8 to get 64? That would be 2. We know 8 squared is 64. Cool. All right. Here. So guess what? Sometimes you might get an answer that looks like this, but you won't see this as an answer choice, right? You're like, well, what the hell? Why don't I see this as an answer choice? This is because when you add two logs of the same base, you can combine them and make one log. But we can't do that right now because there's a coefficient of this 4 here and that 2 here are kind of cock-blocking that combination. So we're going to move this 4. Oh, there's a packet over here, over there. Okay. Move the 4 up as an exponent there, 2 up as an exponent there. So we get log base 7 of 2 to the 4th plus log base 7 of 9. Or I should say 3 squared, whoops, whatever. When it got ahead of myself. Again, when I add two logs of the same base, I multiply them. 24 times 9 is 216. Good job, everyone. So that is the number that goes here. 216 is your answer. Sorry, I'm an idiot. This is where I would take a shot immediately, right? Sorry, I'm so dumb. It looks like a 24. 2 to the 4th is 16.
try that again. 16 times 9 is log base 7 of 144. It's always a good sign when your tutor is already drunk. No, I'm kidding.
Just drunk on that. I heard murmuring back there, and these guys have been here since like the last half an hour, and so I knew that when I heard murmuring back there, they were like on top of their game, so I knew I'd goofed.
Don't write your 2 to the 4 to look like a 24, like me, okay? We go on that problem. All right. What happens when I do e to ln? What happens with the e to the ln? They cancel. So e to the ln of 12 is just 12. All right, let's factor. We have x cubed minus 3x squared minus 3x plus 9. We're going to do factor by grouping. This is a technique that a lot of people have forgotten or saw one day in class and was like, cool, I'm never going to have to do that ever again. So let's give this a shot. I'm going to draw like a little vertical bar separating the first two terms from the second two terms. What can I factor out of the first two terms?
X to the second.
Good. And what I'm left with is x minus 3.
What can I factor out of the second two terms? I can factor out a 3. I'm actually going to factor out a negative 3. The reason I'm doing that deliberately because I know that I want to have x minus 3 left over when I factor that out. I want to have the same thing in parentheses here as I did when I first factored out the x squared from the first two terms. Oh, this is great because if I factor, now that I factor out x minus, or I have an x minus 3 here and an x minus 3 here, guess what? Both terms have an x minus 3, which means I can factor out what? Grab a pack of guys. What can I factor out from both of those terms? What? X minus 3. So I'm going to factor out x minus 3. What would I have left? Well, if I factor out an x minus 3 out of an x squared times x minus 3, I'm left with an x squared. If I factor out x minus 3 from a 3, or 3 times x minus 3, I'm left with minus 3 equals 0. All right. For the remaining peanut butter cup, who can tell me the three solutions? Raise your hand when you got it. Yes. All right, good, nice. I'll get it. We won't leave it there for them. Tomorrow's, or I guess not tomorrow, but Monday's class.
Okay, so she's exactly right. She said x equals 3, and x equals root 3, and x equals negative root 3. Good?
Okay, let's look at this next one. This is not an equation, this is an inequality, okay? So we're going to figure out the values of x that make the numerator 0 and the values of x that make the denominator 0. I'm looking at that numerator and thinking, how in the world does that factor? Some of you might know how a difference or sum of cubes factors, so let's kind of figure out how something like that factors. We always have a binomial term and a trinomial term. And again, we're trying to factor the x cubed minus 8. Watch for a second, don't write anything down. What is the cube root of this first term? What's the cube root of x cubed? It's just what? Just x. What's the cube root of 8?
2.
Okay. Now, we've got our binomial term ready. Square this term. What's x squared? Oh, sorry. What's the square of this guy? Let's see that. X squared. What's the square of this guy? 4. We're going to put him at the end. What is the product of these two terms? 2x, right? Just the product x times 2 is going to give me 2x. And now you're like, great. We're missing signs. What are the signs? Well, anytime you factor a difference or a sum of two cubes, you got to use soap. It's a dirty project. You got to use soap, okay? Soap. You're like, what the fuck is he talking about? What is soap? Okay. Soap is same, opposite, always positive, all right? Same as in same sign as we saw in the numerator, right? What do we see there? We see a minus, so same sign. O for opposite, so opposite of the minus is a plus. And then the AP stands for always positive. So that's how that factors. It turns out that when we factor this difference or sum of cubes, this won't factor. This produces no factors. You'll get imaginary numbers like that square root of negative 1, like I plus or minus square root of negative 1. Those don't count. So the only thing that we're going to get that causes this to equal 0 is x equals what?
2.
My finger's doing like the little matrix thing, like Neo, like dodging bullets. Okay. 2, right? So we have x equals 2. What value of x causes my denominator to be 0?
Negative 2.
So x equals 2 causes my numerator to be 0. X equals negative 2 causes my denominator to be 0.
Now, these aren't solutions. These are just values of x that I'm going to mark down on a number line, and then from there determine whether or not I've got something that satisfies the inequality or not. So let's draw a number line. Here's negative 2. Here's 2. I'm going to ask this guy who's smart to bring his own dinner, pick your favorite number larger than 2. 3. Wow. A little original.
No, it's a good one. All right. 3. When I cube, 3 cubed is what? 27. 27 minus 8 is positive or negative? Positive, right? 3 times 2 is 6 plus 4 is also positive. So we have a positive over positive, which is a positive. Is a positive larger than 0? Yes, so we're going to put a check mark on that interval that contains 3. Remember, he chose 3, so I'm putting a check mark on the over the interval that that has 3 in, as part of it. Okay? You, sir, pick your favorite number between negative 2 and 2. What's everyone's favorite number between a negative and a positive? 0. So let's plug in 0. I helped you there. 0 minus 8 is negative 8. 0 plus 4 is 4. Negative 8 over 4 is negative 2. It's a negative number. Is a negative larger than 0? No. So plug in an x over that interval. Pick your favorite number less than negative 2. Claire, right?
Negative 4.
Negative 4 cubed is negative 64 minus 8 is negative 7, a negative number. Over negative 2 times, or 4 times negative 2, negative 8 minus 4 is a negative. Negative over negative is a positive. It's a, all right, two wrongs don't make a right, but a positive. Wait, shit, I always mess that up. Two wrongs don't make a right, but two negatives make a positive. There we go. Okay, so negative over negative is a positive. Is a positive? Is a positive larger than 0? Yes, it is. So we're going to put a check there. You guys are having a good time. Yeah, you have a question?
Oh, I was going to ask you if you believe negative 2 and 2.
That's a great question. We're going to get there in a second. Perfect. Let's do that. What? Okay. So she asked, do we include 2 or negative 2? We're going to shade this guy, shade that interval. We're going to shade this interval. Okay. 2 is a value of x that causes the numerator to be 0, right? 2 cubed is 8 minus 8 is 0. Is this expression allowed to equal 0 according to my inequality sign?
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah, so I'm going to bubble in the 2. It's almost like taking a standardized test again. Bubble in that little 2. And then we're asked ourselves, what about negative 2? Well, negative 2 is a value of x that caused my denominator to be 0. Are you allowed to divide by 0? No. So we're going to put an open circle on that guy. All right, let's try and express this number line in interval notation. This interval ends at negative 2 and goes all the way down towards negative infinity. So we're going to say from negative infinity up to 2, not including 2. So I'm going to put a parenthesis on that 2 because we have an open circle around it. And we say union. Say that this interval plus this other guy. What's the next interval? Well, the next interval starts where? Starts at 2, including 2. So we're going to put a bracket here, or a square brace. God. Yes. This is where I would... But today is not that day. Yes. Sure. No, great question. So x cubed minus 8, I factored into x minus 2 times x squared plus 2x plus 4. Got this one? This one makes sense that that's why you get 2 here? What value of x makes that 0 down there in the denominator? Not 2.
I mean negative 2.
Negative 2. So those are my two special values. Those are the two values that either make my top 0 or bottom 0. And those are the ones that matter. Cool? By the way, keep in mind that this only works once you have the right-hand side equal to what?
0.
Must have. If it's a 1 or a 2 or an x, you have to subtract that over and combine it and make the big fraction, absorb it and make one big fraction, okay? You can do just a sort of common denominator sort of thing, but you need to have 0 on the right-hand side. Okay, next problem. Ln of x squared minus 9 equals 2. How am I going to tackle that one? There's an x squared trapped on the inside of an ln, so what should I do to both sides?
Exponentiate.
Eat, exponentiate. I like the way you use that. People say, I'm going to e it. What does that mean? I'm going to e it. Is e a verb now? We're going to exponentiate it. So we do e to both sides. E to the ln of x squared minus 9 is going to cancel the ln. So we have x squared minus 9 equals e squared. I'm going to add 9 to both sides. Oops, e squared. And then what should I do?
Square root
of both sides, so that gives me x equals what? You're missing something. Anytime you take a square root to solve for a variable, you have to introduce a plus or minus. Okay? All right, ready for this? What is the square root of 100?
10.
Just 10. Don't say plus or minus 10 because we weren't solving for a variable. But if I said x squared equals 100, what would you say? X is plus or minus 10. Okay? Keep in mind, if you're solving for a variable, as we were doing here, we have to introduce a plus or minus. But if I just say, hey, what's the square root of 36? You say 6. Cool? All right. We got 3 more on this page.
Question.
Yes?
Wouldn't that just turn into x is equal to
3 plus e? No. Square roots do not distribute over addition. Square roots distribute over multiplication. So this is a mistake a lot of people make. Square root of x squared plus y squared is not equal to x plus y. We can't just take the square root of the x squared and take the square root of the y squared. You have to leave it like that. That was actually something I meant to say. I was like, so can we simplify this? And some of you might have said yes. And guess what? This is a trick one. There's a plus here. Can't take a square root off. If it was a times, if it's 9 times e squared, then you're absolutely right. You can square root the 9, square root the e squared, and you get 3e. But there's a plus there, so game over. All right, let's get some blue out. I think we've got used too much red and green. All right, 30x squared e to the 2x minus 12x squared e to the 2x. What can I let's look at each term and say, what can I factor out of each group? What can I factor out of the 30 and the 12? What's their greatest common factor? I think there's something bigger. Six. What else can I? Now, what's the next thing? I look at the x squared and the x cubed. What can I factor out of that? X squared. Then I have e to the 2x. That's part of both, so I'm going to factor out an e to the 2x. I like to draw a giant bracket to say, okay, here's what I have left. All right? I pulled the 6 out of 30. Pulling 6 out of 30 gives me 5. I pulled x squared out of x squared gives me 1. You can say times 1 if you prefer. I pulled e to the 2x out of e to the 2x, so you can say, again, times 1 because that went away. It's redundant and almost sometimes silly to say times 1, but some people like to write it because it makes them feel good about, oh, that's, I remember that. I previously had an x squared and e to the 2x there. I remember I pulled that out, okay? How about over here? I pulled out a 6, so I'm going to have a minus 2. I pulled out an x squared from an x cubed. It's going to leave me with an x. And I pulled out an e to the 2x from e to the 2x. So I have just times 1. Whoops. Okay, and it's all equals 0. When you have a product of a bunch of terms that equal 0, you ask yourself, when is each term, each part of those factors equal to 0? So when is 6 equal to 0? Trick question. Never. 6 don't change for no one, okay? Now. We don't care about that. What about x squared? When is this guy equal to 0?
When x is 0.
When x is 0. When is e to the 2x equal to 0? Huh. Never. Why is e to the 2x never equal to 0? Because it's always positive. You should always know what this graph looks like. The e to the x graph looks like this. Where is it sitting relative to the x-axis? It's sitting above the x-axis, so you know it's got to be positive. Cool? Another, we have this over here. We have a 5 minus 2x equals 0. This equals 0 for x equals 5 halves. Good. Let's keep it going. Any questions on that, by the way? All right, when you have a fraction equal to 0, only the numerator needs to equal 0. Did someone text me, we're in the building, but we can't find it? Oh, shit. Oh, it was you? Okay. Hey, everyone point and laugh at her. I'm just kidding.
I can't find it.
Oh, it's fine. Yeah, it's kind of weird because it's obviously off to the not, like, inside the building. It's kind of weird. So, sorry, I didn't mean to call you out, but I was like, I was worried. If you weren't here, I would have been extremely worried. I'm like, oh, my God, I don't know where she is. So, I wanted to make sure everyone's here. All right. I'm going to square. So I'm looking at just the square root of 5 minus 3x, set that equal to 0. I'm going to square both sides. So that gives me 5 minus 3x equals 0 squared. Well, guess what? 0 squared is just 0. And then solve for x. X would equal 5 thirds.
Only the top,
right? When you have a fraction that equals 0, what's the only thing that matters? The numerator. What's that? I don't think so. Now you take the shot. All right, this last one. Sine of 2x equals cosine of x. Yes. Oh, question.
Back in the second grouping, is it 5 halves or negative 5
halves? This is 5 halves as well.
Wait, shouldn't it be negative 5 halves?
I don't think so. So I have 5 minus 2x equals 0. If I add 2x to both sides, that gives me 5 equals 2x, so x equals 5 halves.
Oh.
Cool?
Oh, yeah.
That's all right. Make sure we get all these mistakes out now and not on the exam, right? Okay, last one. Sine 2x equals cosine of x. I'm going to rewrite sine 2x as 2 sine x cosine of x. This is an identity you should know. Who knew that identity? Good. Some of you were like, I've seen it before, but I wouldn't have thought to use it here. Remember, that might come into play on your exam. Okay, I'm going to subtract cosine from both sides. This is the proper way to solve something. Don't divide through by cosine of x. Subtract cosine of x over. 2 sine of x minus 1 equals 0. So once again, I have a product of two terms that both equal. I'm going to set them both equal to 0. Cosine of x equals 0 at x equals pi over 2 and 3 pi over 2. This guy over here is saying sine of x is equal to 1 half. Oh boy, got to know our unit circle. When is sine of x equal to 1 half?
Pi over
6 and? 5 pi over 6. So those are all our solutions. Again, they probably would say something like on the interval from 0 to 2 pi.
Otherwise, you're going to have that plus 2 pi n term on the fraction on the end. Because you say circle around the unit circle over and over and over forever. Right?
All right. Hopefully, that first page was mostly painless. We're good on that? Awesome. Talk a little bit about rational functions, because rational functions make up a lot about a lot of pre-calc, but also a lot of questions that have to do with limits, derivatives, differentiability, continuity. All that stuff comes into play when we talk about these rational functions. So rational function is some function of x over some function of y where both p of x and q of x are polynomials. So these are all examples of rational functions here, 1 over x, 3x squared, blah, blah, blah. Now, let's talk about certain characteristics of a rational function. Values of x that cause the numerator to be 0 but not the denominator are x-intercepts. Values of x that cause the denominator to be 0 but not the numerator cause vertical asymptotes. Values of x that cause both numerator and denominator to be 0 cause what? Holes. All right, finding horizontal asymptotes. If the degree of the numerator is larger than that of the denominator, there's no horizontal asymptote. If the degree of the numerator is smaller than that of the denominator, y equals 0 is your horizontal asymptote. Remember, an asymptote is a line that a graph approaches but never touches. It's very much like our relationship with girls. They let me get as close as I want, but they haven't touched. Okay, if the degree of the numerator equals the degree of the denominator, use the ratio of leading coefficients, which I write as a over b. Y equals a over b. With that in mind, let's tackle these next two. I'm going to factor the numerator. Factor the denominator. This factors into 3x, x, say plus 1, minus 4. Yeah. What do you mean? Would what be 3?
Never mind.
Go ahead. Okay. Now, I have 3x minus 4 times x plus 1 over x minus 1 times x plus 1. Notice x-intercepts would be 4/3, right? 4/3 is the value of x that causes my numerator to be 0, but not my denominator. Vertical asymptote. What values of x cause my denominator to be 0, but not the numerator? Negative 1. I'm going to skip the horizontal asymptote for a second and go to holes. What values of x cause the top end? Oh, shit. X equals 1, not x equals negative 1. Negative 1 is the guy that causes the top and bottom to be 0. So negative 1 is the x-coordinate of the hole. How do I get the y-coordinate of the hole? Plug it in after you cross out the x plus 1. So I'm going to cross this out and now plug in negative 1. Negative 1 times 3 is negative 3 minus 4 is negative 7. Negative 1 minus 1 is negative 2, so I get positive 7/2. Horizontal asymptote, notice the degree of the top and the degree of the bottom are the same. So I can just say it's y equals 3 over 1. There's a coefficient of 1 there, so 3 over 1 is just 3. We good on that? We're going to skip to this problem here. Actually, you know what? I'm wondering if this might be I pepper these in every now and then if I feel like we're moving too slow, or some people are like, yeah, I got it. I'll just do a try at home sort of thing. Try at home and then just, you know, ask me. You can send me an email at easyatcalculus@gmail.com, or you could tweet at me, any sort of thing like that. Yeah?
How did you get the x-intercept
from the other one? What value of x causes the numerator to be 0?
Okay, so just that plus 1. Okay.
Right. So 4/3 causes the top to be 0, but not the bottom. That's important. Trig review, in case you don't know your unit circle, you might want to fill this out. So here I go. I don't really have a good trick for you guys to how to memorize the entire thing. There's a tip at the bottom that I'll address in a second. While you guys are filling that out, I do want to talk about the tangent of pi over 6 to the tangent of pi over 3. It's something that I haven't heard before. Yeah,
Okay, I want everyone to notice at pi over 6, what's the value of tangent? We see it's root 3 over 3, correct?
What is 3 and 3? 3 to 3, when you add 3 and 3, what do you get? 6. Okay, what about tangent of pi over 3? Well, how many 3s do you see here? Just a regular 3? And we have pi over 3 here.
So that can help you distinguish between tangent of pi over 6, that would be root 3 over 3, because there's 2 3s, and tangent of pi over 3, that should be 1 3, just root 3. Good?
Make sure you can make your unit circle. Now, the most important part about making your unit circle is just make sure you know the first quadrant, because if you know the first quadrant, you can just about get any other angle you want. So this would be root 3 over 2, comma 1 half. This will be root 2 over 2, comma root 2 over 2. This will be 1 half, comma root 3 over 2. This is 1, 0, and this is 0, 1. And this is pi over 6, pi over 4, pi over 3, 0, and pi over 2.
If you want to, in the comfort of your own home, fill out the whole unit circle. It's good practice. But you should also keep in mind that if you don't fill out the whole unit circle, knowing how everything works in the first quadrant will allow you to figure out how everything works in other quadrants. For instance, if we're looking at sine 5 pi over 3, what family are we in? We're in the pi over 3 family. What is the sine of pi over 3? It's root 3 over 2. Cool. So we know my answer should be something like root 3 over 2. I'm going to go ahead and write that down. But it may be negative. Where is 5 pi over 3? We have pi over 3. This is where I get to pirouette like a little ballerina. Pi over 3, 2 pi over 3. This is 4 pi over 3 down here. So 5 pi over 3 puts me in the fourth quadrant. In the fourth quadrant, who's positive?
Cosine.
Cosine's positive. So that means sine is negative. So we're going to put a negative right in front there. What kind of mnemonic device do you guys use to remember the quadrants?
All
students take calculus. So in the first quadrant, all the functions are positive. In the second quadrant, the sines are positive. In the third quadrant, tangents are positive. In the fourth quadrant, cosines are positive. Cool? Here we have cosine 3 pi over 4. Once again, what family are we in? Pi over 4, right? So pi over 4, what is cosine of pi over 4? It is root 2 over 2. So I'm just going to go ahead and say root 2 over 2 and ascertain whether or not it's going to be negative there or positive. Well, 3 pi over 4 is in what quadrant? That's pi over 4? Second quadrant. In the second quadrant, sine is positive, so that means cosine is negative. And lastly, tangent of 5 pi over 6. What is the so what's the family? The tangent family is pi over 6. What's the tangent of pi over 6? Root 3 over 3, we talked about a second ago, root 3 over 3. And then 5 pi over 6 puts us in which quadrant? Second quadrant, where cosine, or where sine again is positive, therefore tangent is negative, so we're going to have a negative here. Cool? Hopefully it's a quick crash course on your unit circle, on trig. Here's a lot of identities you can memorize. I kind of left a few off here, so here's just need to fill these out. The even odd identities I want you to fill out. When you plug in a negative into the sine, you can pull it out. So it becomes negative sine theta. When you have a negative on the inside of a cosine, it just can evaporate. So it will just become cosine theta. Tangent is like sine in that when you pull the negative out of the tangent, it sits on the outside the tangent. So basically, cosine absorbs the negative, whereas sine and tangent, you have to take it outside. Why?
Yes.
It's, all right. That's actually, okay, that's probably a question you should ask at the break. So there's a lot to it, more than just I can explain here. But basically, it has something to do with the way the sine curve looks, way the cosine curve looks, way the tangent curve looks. So that's the short answer. A couple things here, sum and difference formulas. Not that I think they're going to come up with these, but just in case, when you have plus or minus here, use plus or minus here. That's basically when you use a plus in the middle between x and y, use plus here. If there's a minus between x and y, use a minus. Cosine is not quite that way. Cosine, if you had cosine of x plus or minus y, it's going to be minus or plus. Not that I think those formulas are going to be that popular or going to show up too much. I think the ones that are going to show up quite a bit are these. These are the ones you need to know. Memorize. Make sure you have those down at the very least. If you want to study more of them, good. You should know more of them. But if you had to pick two pieces of this page, I would pick this side, these two together. Good? We are cruising. Oh, I forgot to do the Snapchat thing. I usually give my Snapchat handle right here because what people like to do is they like to snap a photo of me and then draw like a clown face on me, and then we open them at the break and see what all your creations were. But we'll do that for exam two. Speaking of which, does anyone need any candy? Because I know some people need a sugar rush. Oops, I missed. Off the head.
Anyone else? Yeah? Okay. Okay. So there's more. There's actually there's blow pops too. Holy shit. They're not blow pops. They're knockoff blow pops. Who wants the burnt orange one? Back there. They don't fly like. Oh, they did fly pretty well. Man, his been pretty good. He hasn't. He just puts his hand where it needs to be and then clutches. Okay. You're good over here. Okay. All right. Graphs of common functions. I'm gonna go through these real quick. Y equals X is your 45 degree line. Like that. Domain is all reals. Range is all reals. Y equals X squared is a parabola. We know what that one looks like. Domain is also all reals, but the range is only from 0 to infinity, only positive numbers or 0. Y equals square root of X looks like this. And it's just handy to know these, by the way. They're going to be handy if you're ever asked to plot a piecewise function or they ask you to evaluate a limit. Knowing what a graph looks like is going to help either evaluate a limit or plot some functions, plot some points. Y equals X cubed. If you know what this one looks like. Kind of screwed the pooch on that one. It's fine. Domain's all reals. Range is all reals. Cube root of X looks very similar to X cubed, except it's kind of flipped over the line. Y equals X. There we go. Kind of flipped it over because it's an inverse function. Same thing here. All reals. All reals for the range and the domain. That's a real looking R. Absolute value of X, everyone knows what this looks like, right? Domain is all reals, but the range is only positive, or basically non-zero numbers. Non-negative. Positive or zero. Okay? And we all have been like dreading what this whole function is and why this messes things up with differentiability, right? We all talk about, what this function's continuous, but not differentiable. What does that mean? We'll get there in a minute. Okay, the bottom three, we have y equals e to the x, helps know what this guy looks like. Domain is all reals. Range is positive numbers only, not including zero. Ln of x is the inverse of that. Domain is 0 to infinity, and range is all reals. Y equals 1 over x looks like this. Domain is everything except 0. Same for the range. All reals except x equals 0. How many of you knew most of those graphs? That's good. That's a good sign, right? If you didn't know a few, if you did a couple, you're like, oh, I didn't know what that looked like. That's good. That's fine. You know, we're going to make sure you know all nine of those. And maybe you've seen that cartoon where there's like a, it's like a, do the math dance, and it's all the, there's the x cubed, or I guess for you guys, there's the x cubed. Do the absolute value, right? It's so stupid. Anyway, I'm an idiot. Look up the comic for yourself. Piecewise function. Piecewise functions defined in, well, pieces. In order to graph them, just plot to get pieces over their specified domains. What I'm going to do here is I'm going to use a trick that I used at the very bottom called the junction point. So what I'm going to do is what's the junction point for this guy? Where do these two pieces meet at x equals
1?
I'm going to plug in 1 to both the top piece and the bottom piece. When I plug in 1 to the top piece, what do I get? 2 minus 1 is? Try again. 1. So here's 1. When I plug in 1, I get 1. So 1 comma 1. I'm going to put an open circle here. Why am I putting an open circle there for that piece?
I don't know if it's continuous.
Not quite. That's not quite why. It's more so that the less than or equal. It doesn't say less than or equal to. It just says less than 1. I think I heard someone say it over here. It just says less than 1, right? It doesn't say less than or equal to 1. For the other piece, plug in 1 here. What's 1 minus 3? Negative 2. For this guy, I am going to put a closed circle because this says for x greater than or equal to 1. So basically, you're going to plot either an open circle or a closed circle depending on whether or not you see less than or equal to, greater than or equal to, greater than, less than. All right? Once we have that, you can do whatever you want on the right-hand side. I don't mean whatever you want, like draw, woo, I'll draw whatever I want. No, you can do it at whatever method you want to in order to figure out what happens on the right. What shape is the line? Great, almost. Huh? What shape is the graph y equals x minus 3? A line. Okay, great. X minus 3, it's a line with a slope of 1 and a y-intercept of negative 3. So you say, okay, it's going to continue upward this way. Or you can plot points. So I just knew that's a line with a slope of 1. It's going to keep going up 1 over 1, up 1 over 1. Or I can say instead, I'm going to pick another point. Pick your favorite number less than 1. What's the easiest number you can pick?
0.
Plug in 0. 0 squared is 0. 2 minus 0 is 2. So that puts that point here. Let's plot one other point. Let's pick negative 1. Negative 1 squared is 1. 2 minus 1 is 1. So that means negative 1 comma 1 is also a point on my graph. So I'm seeing this sort of behavior happen. And that makes sense because this is a downward opening parabola. So that just makes sense. Over to me. All right. Hey. All right. Next one. We have three pieces here. Two for x less than 0. Two is just a horizontal line. If you see this guy, that's just a horizontal line. The horizontal line x equals 2. So here's 1, 2. Just that horizontal line. And again, I'm going to put an open circle there at x equals 0 because it says x is less than 0. It doesn't say x is less than or equal to 0. It says x is less than 0. So it's got to be open circle, right? All right, square root of x for values of x between 0 and 4. Let's evaluate the square root of x at the junction point. What's the square root of 0? 0. We're going to put a closed circle or an open circle? Closed, because it says x is greater than or equal to 0. So I'm going to put a closed circle down here. Let's try this junction point, x equals 4. Plug in 4 to the middle piece. What's the square root of 4? 2. Square root of 4 is 2, so I go over 1, 2, 3, 4, and go up to 2. But I'm going to put an open circle there, because it says less than 4, strictly less than 4. You're good on that? Okay. When I plug in, so I saw a look of fear in your eyes, which I usually see when I see people taking calculus. They're like, okay, just take me now. I'm done. Okay, goodbye. But anyway, when I plug in 4 for 3 minus x, I get 3 minus 4 is negative 1, so that gives me this guy, and this is going to be also an open circle. At this point, you're like, great, we get to play connect the dots. I remember that when I was at Applebee's. Had the kids menu. Okay, we're going to play this connect over here. We're going to connect those. That's what the square root of x function looks like. Remember our graphs, our common graphs from the previous page. There's square root of x. And 3 minus x is a downward sloping line, slope of negative 1. So there's your piecewise looking function. And at this point, we can start asking questions about, is it continuous at 4? Is it differentiable at 4? Is it continuous at 0? Is it differentiable at 0? You know, asking those questions. We clearly see that it's neither continuous, it's not continuous at 0 nor at 4, and therefore it's not differentiable there, right? But that's a spoiler alert. We don't want to talk about that just yet. Cool? Oh, before you turn the page, though, what kind of discontinuities are these called? Jump discontinuity. Good. All right, limits. Here we go. So, in case you haven't gone to class a single day, this page is for you. All right. In order to evaluate a limit just by looking at a graph, we trace our pencil from the left to the right depending on what direction we're asking you to approach from. So we start over here. We're asking the limit as x approaches 5 from the left. We see that 5 with a superscript of a negative. Put our pencil here. We trace our pencil, and we go up to we go over to 5, and then we attain the y value of 3. So I say 3. Same thing for the right now. I take my pencil, put it on the curve, trace it towards 5, but now we're approaching this time from the right, hence the plus as a superscript. And notice as we do so, we approach the y value of 6. We approach the y value of 6. So that's why the limit from the right is 6. Now the discontinuity, as we talked about, the discontinuity created as a result of these two limits being different is called a jump. Not to beat a dead horse, sorry. In the next graph, we see that the limit from the left and from the right as x approaches 5 is 3 on both sides. Limit from the left, we see, is 3. Limit from the right is 3. Guess what? Those limits match, right? When limits match, the limit exists. The two-sided limit exists, and it's equal to that number, in this case, 3. Note that the limit here exists despite the fact that the function isn't defined, or isn't the value of the function isn't 3 at x equals 5. So keep in mind that even though f of 5 equals 6, the two-sided limit still exists and is still 3. What sort of discontinuity is created here? This is called a removable discontinuity. But you know what I like to say? Because if you say removable discontinuity, it takes you a few years to say it. By the time you finish saying it, you're already a junior. So just say hold. Makes it easy. Or write out removable discontinuity on your exam. Cool? Next page. Graphical limits, these are pretty easy. If they show you a graph and they ask you to find a limit, just start tracing your pencil. Fun little game. What's the limit as x approaches negative 4? Well, I'm going to do this in two pieces. I need to evaluate the limit from the left and the limit from the right. So everyone watch me for a second. As I trace my pen from the left of negative 4, for what y value do I approach? 6. So I get 6 from the left. What do I get as I approach negative 4 from the right? 3, negative 3. Do those values match? No, because those values don't match, the two-sided limit as x approaches negative 4, what? Does not exist. Limit as x approaches 7 of f of x. What's the limit as x approaches 7 from the left? Looks to be 2, right? What's the limit as x approaches 7 from the right? Looks also to be 2. So guess what? The left-hand limit is 2, the right-hand limit is 2, and because they match, the overall two-sided limit is 2. Good? This is I've seen this test question show up on a couple exams in fall 2015 and fall 2012. Not this question exactly, but they want you to evaluate some limits, then they give you a piecewise function, okay? Here's this piecewise function. One thing you can do is just graph it. I'll show you a quicker way. We can graph it really quick. I'm going to graph it really quick for you guys. And then 2x plus 1, okay, 3, okay. I think that's what that looks like, but it's not important. Or in fact, you don't even need to copy that down in order to do this problem. Ready? Here's how I do this problem. Or at least for x approaching 3, when x is approaching 3, guess what? I just find the drawer that it belongs to. Which drawer is x equals 3 in? The top drawer or the bottom drawer? Bottom drawer. Just plug it in. What's 3 times 2? Minus 1 is? Wow, that was really simple. Man, is calculus always this easy? No. Just plug in 3. 3 times 2 is 6 minus 1 is 5. Now, the next limit is limit as x approaches 2, but what's wrong with that? That's what I call a junction point. That junction point serves as a gap between one to the next. So how do I figure out that limit? Well, I'm going to plug in 2 to the top piece and to the bottom piece. Why was I plug in 2 to the top piece? What's 2 squared minus 2? 2. 2 squared is 4 minus 2 is 2, right? Plug in 2 to the bottom piece. What's 2 times 2? 4 minus 1 is 3, right? Do those limits match? Did those match when I plugged in 2 to the top piece and 2 to the bottom piece? No match, so guess what? Does not exist. Notice you don't actually have to graph it. A lot of people think they have to graph it. Now, some professor might say, plot this, in which case you got to. But if he just says, here's a piecewise function, evaluate the limit as x approaches 2, just plug 2 to the top piece, plug 2 to the bottom piece. If they match, great, that's your number. If they don't match, doesn't exist. Good? For the function, f of x equals 2 squared of x and all these different blah, 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 blah. Again, you can graph it if you want to. It looks very similar to one we did on the previous page, but I'll let you guys graph it on your own. Limit as x approaches 0 of f of x. Well, look, 0 is a junction point, so we're going to plug 0 into both pieces. When I plug 0 into the top piece, what do I get? 2. It's always a 2, right? There's no variable in there. It's just always going to be 2 no matter what value x is. So we have 2 to the top piece. What happens when I plug in 0 to the middle piece here? Square root of 0 is 0. 2 and 0, do those match? No. Who wants me to slow down? Anyone? Okay, we're good. Just a little bit?
Yeah.
A tad? Okay. Notice the top piece and the middle piece. I'm going to plug in 0 for both of those pieces, and when I do, I get 2 for the top piece and 0 for the middle piece. So guess what? Does not exist because the top piece was 2. Doesn't match 0. Let's look at the bottom piece, or the bottom piece, but the limit as x approaches 1. We're going to plug in 1 to the middle piece. What's the square root of 1? 1. What is 3 minus 2 times 1? 1. So guess what? The middle piece and the bottom piece match at x equals 1, so the limit exists at x equals 1, and that limit is 1. Cool? Next page. Strategies for evaluating limits without a graph. The technique is start by always doing what first? Always plug in. Always plug in to start. Okay? When you do so, you're going to see three cases. You're going to get non-zero over non-zero, which is great. You get like 3 over 5. We're done. Yeah. But guess what? That's like 10% of cases, unfortunately. So, yeah, I know. This guy's pissed. So I plug in. If I get zero, non-zero over non-zero, then I'm good. That's my number. If I get 0 over 0, I have to factor, cancel, conjugate, simplify, common denominator, all those sort of techniques that you know to simplify your fraction are what you're going to do in order to get an answer. If I get non-zero over 0, the limit is infinity, negative infinity, or does not exist, and it's up to you to determine which. You do so by picking values slightly larger or slightly less than the approach limit value. We're going to see all of those cases in these few problems. Ready? Plug in 3. What do I get? 0 over 0. Big surprise there. Big surprise. I'm going to factor the numerator, factor the denominator. I factored a negative 2 out of the denominator because I knew it was coming. Plug in 3. When I plug in 3, well, I don't want to plug in 3 because it's going to be 0 over 0. So I'm going to cancel those out, leaving me with x plus 3 over negative 2. Some professors and TAs are finicky about this. They want you, 3. Some professors and TAs are finicky about this. They want you to continue writing limit as x approaches 3 all the way down. So it's kind of annoying. They're cool. They're like, whatever. They don't care if you write limit as x approaches 3 all the way down. But some TAs are like, every time you don't write it, I'm going to dock you a point. Okay? So that's really annoying. Oh, no. Your eyes went like, what? But just keep writing limit as x approaches 3. Ask your TA. I couldn't speak for your TA because obviously different TAs differ, but some TAs don't care because they're like, it's whatever, dude.
I think I'll test for multiple choice.
Well, right. Okay. Then if some people test for multiple choice. Some people have different sections and therefore don't have quite the same as you.
I think they will eventually get to multiple choice.
All right. So we're going to plug in 3. 3 plus 3 is 6 over negative 2 is negative 3. All right, I'm looking at this next one. I'm going to go ahead and spoil it for you at 0 over 0. So something's got to factor, conjugate something or other. How do we factor the numerator? We talked about this a minute ago. Every sum or difference of cube factors into a binomial times a trinomial. I'm going to take the cube root of the 8x cubed, that's a 2x, and take the cube root of 27, that's 3. You guys remember how I'm getting that? I'm taking the cube root of the 8x cubed, that's 2x. Taking the cube root of 27, that's a 3. How do I get the remaining terms? Square this beast here, you get what? 2x when I square that gives me 4x squared. I look at the 3, I square that guy. 3 squared we know is 9. We take the product of the two binomial terms, in this case 2x and 3, to get 6x, and that's our middle term. And then how do we make sure what the signs are? We use what? Soap. Same as in the same sign as what we saw in the beginning. So we saw a plus in the middle. So we're going to say same sign. Say soap across the top. Soap stands for same, opposite, always positive. So because we saw a plus from the very beginning, we're going to use a plus. We use minus over the opposite sign. We have a plus, we use the opposite. And then AP stands for always positive. All divided by 2x plus 3. Hey, that's great because guess what? The 2x plus 3 is canceled. So now it's safe for me to plug in negative 3 halves, and at that point I'm going to say, great, what is negative 3 halves squared? Negative 3 halves squared is 9 fourths times 4 is 9, plus 9, plus, it's going to be 27. Cool. Next one. Any questions on that? All right, whenever we see a square root of 4x plus 1 minus 3 over x minus 2, whenever we see a square root of that numerator, what do we think to do? Conjugate. As soon as you see a square root, you think maybe I need to do a conjugate here. And that's what we want to do here. I'm going to draw some parentheses. Square root of 4x plus 1 plus 3 over square root of 4x plus 1 plus 3. That is the conjugate of the square root of 4x plus 1 minus 3. When I FOIL out the numerator, that four-letter F word, FOIL, when I FOIL that out, I'm going to get, well, it's a nice form. It's what's called a difference of squares. So what's going to happen is it's just this guy squared minus this guy squared. So my numerator will just become 4x plus 1 minus 9. I know there is no point in bothering to write out the OI in FOIL. OI. No point in writing that out because the outside and the inside terms are going to cancel. We're going to leave this guy factored, x minus 2 times square root of 4x plus 1 plus 3. Now notice 4x plus 1 minus 9 is the same thing as 4x minus 8. But 4x minus 8 is 4 times x minus 2, which is lovely. If nothing else, calculus makes gives your wrist a workout, doesn't it? All these friggin' conjugates, and by the time you've filled up a half sheet of paper for one limit. Yeah? Say again?
I
Oh, this guy right here? Yeah.
Good catch, good catch. I wouldn't consider that a mistake, by the way. I'm using my TI-83 in my head, where you don't need to close parentheses on your scientific, on your graphic calculators.
Okay, notice that x minus 2, I have x minus 2 on the top and the bottom. Those will cancel. And now it's safe for me to go ahead and plug in 2. Plug in 2. 2 times 4 is 8, plus 1 is 9, square root of 9 is 3, 3 plus 3 is 6, 4 over 6, better known as 2/3. This next one, I'm going to leave for you guys to try on your own. This is a try at home sort of question. But does anyone know the technique that you're going to use to do this one? Common denominator. So that's what you're going to use to take care of the x over x minus 2 minus 2. Cool? I feel like I have a stutter when I'm saying that. X over x minus 2 minus 2. All right. These next two are among the hardest. These are ones where, do I factor, do I conjugate, do I cancel, what do I do? This first one, you're going to multiply by a conjugate. So anytime you see a sine minus 1 or a cosine minus 1 or a 1 minus sine or a 1 minus cosine, watch carefully. Here's what happens. This one's a doozy. So in order to tackle this problem, you need to know this identity. I can rearrange this guy to look like sine squared theta minus 1 equals negative cosine squared theta. But that's perfect because guess what my numerator is? It's just 9 times whatever I have written down here in green. Sorry for the colorblind. It is negative 9 cosine squared theta all over cosine theta, 3 sine theta plus 3. Some of you are like, wow, I did not think to do that. That's why this one's a little bit trickier than average. In fact, you might want to even put a star next to it because it is just a little bit harder than the ones you've probably seen so far. It requires you to think, I'm going to multiply by the conjugate just randomly. I would have thought to do that. Getting a lot of I'm seeing some blank stares over here and over here and over here. So ask questions if you're lost. Okay, now at this point, I can cancel one of the cosines from the denominator with the one in the numerator, giving me just negative 9 cosine theta over 3 sine theta plus 3. Now that I've done that, now that I've canceled that cosine of theta, I can safely plug in pi over 2. And when I do so, I get negative 9 times cosine of pi over 2 over 3 times 1 plus 3. This is 0 over 6, or 0. Yeah. Cool, good on that one. This one's not so, yeah, go ahead.
I just had a question. Shoot. A different way. If you pulled out a 9 on top, and then you pulled out a 3 on the bottom of the sine, would that make it later plus 3? Could you cancel those
on top? So her question is, what if I cancel out, if I pull a 9 out and pull a 3 out, could I factor that and cancel? If I do that, guess what, it's going to wind me back up, right back where I started. So it looks like you're actually right. It's good that you're looking out for things that cancel because that's often what you want to do. Sometimes people are so cancel happy that they cancel right and go right back to where they started. So it's good that you're pointing that out. But yeah, don't want to cancel here because if you do so, you'll go right back to this. And sometimes that'll happen to you. Sometimes you do another conjugate or do another cancel, and you're like, wait a second, I feel like I'm going in circles. I was just here. Weren't we just here? Yeah. Sometimes you'll feel like that. This next one, sine of x over sine of 2x. You should know that identity of sine of 2x. Sine 2x is better known as what? 2 sine x cosine x. Yeah. Yeah, we could. Well, it would be if the limit was going, well, I guess it was. It would work here because I would stick to only using that when the limit as x goes and going to where? 0. This is going to pi, so I'd hesitate to use it so readily. But yeah, that's a good point. It would actually work here. I think. Oh, maybe it wouldn't. Oh, yes, he actually wouldn't. You're gonna see why I wouldn't. Okay, so everyone look up. I'm going to cancel the signs, leaving me with 1 over 2 cosine of x. Now let's plug in pi. Cosine of pi is negative 1, so I get an answer of negative 1/2. So you see why the wouldn't work there. Stick to that rule, but using when x is going to 0. Cool? Good on that? We've got a few more pages before we take a break. Number over 0 limits. This one you can just do graphically. This is nice. What does 1 over x look like? We talked about it on a previous page. Looks like this, right? What's the limit as x approaches 0 from the right? Where is it going? Let me draw it. As x approaches 0 from the right, where is this guy going? Toward infinity. What about the limit as x approaches 0 from the left? Where is it going? Negative infinity. It's going toward two different infinities, and therefore the overall limit what? Does not exist. It's like that scene from Mean Girls. Now you feel like, man, I'm just living like Katie Heron. All right. 1 over x squared. You might not know what this graph looks like. I can kind of give you a quick sketch if you didn't. Looks like this. But I will talk about what would happen if you didn't know what the graph looks like, because obviously many of you are like, I didn't know what that looked like. How was I supposed to know that? But notice that both from the left and from the right, the graph is going where?
Positive.
Going to positive infinity, so we know this limit will be positive infinity. But let's do it algebraically. Remember, what do my rules say whenever you plug in a number? Let's see, when you get non-zero over 0, which is what we would have gotten here if we plug in 0, we get 1 over 0. We determine which we plug in values of x slightly to the left and slightly to the right. Pick your favorite number slightly larger than 0. I would even go even slighter than that. 0.1. Slighter. 0.1. 0.1 squared is what kind of number? Positive or negative? Positive. So we have 1 over a positive, which is a positive. So it's going to positive infinity from the right. Now pick your favorite number slightly less than 0. Negative 0.1. Negative 0.1. When I plug in negative 0.1, negative 0.1 squared is, again, positive 0.01. 1 over a positive. Positive over a positive is a positive. So guess what? Because I got positive for both sides, I know it's going to positive infinity. Good on that? This one, honestly, this one's not going to be one you really know without looking at the graph. But let me answer your question. Yeah.
Okay, so one of your first learning limits, to my understanding, is that if the limit is going toward infinity, it doesn't exist.
And so... So this is what I was afraid of. Some professors will say that if it's infinity, if any one of those limits is infinity, then it doesn't exist. That might be the case with Bashar.
No, she says it goes from the module we learned from said it doesn't exist, but then when she explained it, she said it does.
Okay, yeah, so it's very contradictory. There's not a good convention, and even the textbook kind of glosses over it. It doesn't say when they both go to infinity, it's infinity. They just say, okay. Moving on, they don't say whether it exists or doesn't exist. They just say it's infinity, but they don't say whether or not that counts as an existing limit. So it's kind of annoying. But I say, and most professors say, this would be a positive infinity. Yep. Mm-hmm. All right. This one, tangent as x approaches theta from, or as theta approaches pi over 2 from the left. You have to know what tangent looks like. I know it's probably been a while since you've seen what tangent looks like, but here's what tangent looks like. Remember that graph from trig? What is the limit as x approaches, or I should say theta approaches pi over 2 from the left? Where is it going?
Positive infinity.
So that's your answer. I'm going to take my pen, start on the left side of pi over 2, and start approaching that direction. As I do so, it's going toward positive infinity. How about this guy? Once again, you should always do what? Plug in. When I plug in 4, I get 4 minus 8 over 4 minus 4 equals negative 4 over 0. So this is number over 0. So it means my answer is infinity, negative infinity, or does not exist. And it's up to me to determine which. All right. We're approaching x. We're approaching 4 from the right, so a number slightly larger than 4. So try something like 4.1. When I plug in 4.1, I get 4.1 minus 8 over 4 minus 4.1 equals negative over negative, which is a positive. So it means my answer is what?
Positive infinity.
Got about 4 more, and then I think we're coming up on a break here, a few pages. Limit as x approaches 0 of the square root of 25 minus x squared. I didn't mean to do this. Change this x approaches 0 to an x approaches 5. Everyone, change the limit as x approaches 0 to x approaches 5. With that in mind, does anyone know the answer to this question? Who thinks it's 0? Who thinks it does not exist? All right. The do not exist have it. It's correct. Do not exist. Doesn't exist. But some of you are like, well, why? Why can't I just plug in 5? This is because the limit needs to exist from the left and the right to exist, right? What's the limit as x approaches 5 from the left? So I plug in something like 4.9. 4.9 squared is 24.01. 25 minus 24.01 is getting me closer to 0, right? What about when I plug in a number like 5.1? Well, 5.1 squared is going to be a number that's larger than 25, so I get 25 minus a number larger than 25. 25 minus a number larger than 25 will be what kind of number? A negative. Can you have a negative under a square root? No. And let's look at this graphically. Here's what the square root of 25 minus x squared looks like. This looks like a semicircle of radius 5. So if I told you to approach x equals 5 from the left, you could safely tell me that that would be 0, because we can see the y value we're approaching is 0. But if I told you to approach 5 from the right, how could you do that? There's not a, where do I start? Right? There's nothing for me to trace along, and because there's not, the limit from the right doesn't exist, and therefore the overall limit does not exist. Does that make sense? Okay.
Wait.
Yes. It would be doesn't exist.
Why?
There's nothing over here. You said from the right or from the left? Because you said from the right.
Oh, okay. Well, if we did from the left.
Yes, that would be 0.
That would be 0. Okay.
Right?
Okay.
So you said right when you meant left.
Yes.
Cool. Limit as x approaches 1 from the right of ln of x minus 1. It helps to know what the graph looks like. Remember, ln of x looks like, we've seen what it looks like on the previous page, but the minus 1 does what to that graph? Shifts it to the right by 1 unit. So we're going to see our vertical asymptote here. And that's what our ln of x graph looks like. Ln of x minus 1, I should say. Notice what's happening as x approaches 1 from the right. Where is it going? It's going towards negative infinity. Before you turn the page, quick bonus question. What's the limit as x approaches 1? Of ln of x minus 1. What do you guys think? Why? Right. Why does it not exist? We know the limit from the right we found to be negative infinity. What's the limit from the left? There's nothing there, right? It's not so much that there's an asymptote as it is there's nothing to trace our finger along, right? There's nothing for us to trace our finger along to get a limit as x approaches 1 from the left, so this limit doesn't exist. I'm sure we've all felt like this before in class. Limit as x approaches 0 of x to the negative 2/3. Let's start by saying limit as x approaches 0 of 1 over x to the 2/3. It's going to help us kind of get a better look at what this function behaves like. And when I plug in 0, what do I get? I get 1 over 0. I get another one of those. It's either infinity, negative infinity, or does not exist. Okay? With that in mind, I ask you, what do we usually do? Pick our favorite number slightly larger than 0. What's your favorite number slightly larger than 0?
0.1.
0.1. When I plug in 0.1 into x to the 2/3, what kind of number do I get? A positive or a negative? Positive. Positive or positive is a?
Positive.
So we get a positive infinity from the right. What about from the left? Pick your favorite number slightly less than 0. Negative 0.1. If I take negative 0.1, everyone look up for a second. If I take negative 0.1 and plug it into x to the 2/3, what do I get? A positive or a negative? Ooh.
What do I get? If I plug in a negative 0.1 into x to the 2/3, what do I get? Positive or negative?
Negative.
Positive. I get a positive.
Why? X to the 2/3. This means the root. This means the power. What do we know about even powers? What do they do to negative numbers? They make them what?
Positive.
So it doesn't matter that the root is a 3. That's fine. It's the power that matters. All right? The power is 2. Because we're plugging in a negative, and that power is an even fact, even number, we're going to get a positive. So we get a positive when we plug in negative 0.1. Positive over positive is a positive. So guess what? This limit is infinity. Limit as x approaches 0 from the right is positive or positive. Limit as x approaches 0 from the left gives me a positive as well. So positive or positive. So it means we have positive infinity from both the left and the right. Okay. We get to use your trick now, right? So, some of you might have encountered these limits before, some of you haven't, but we're going to write these rules down. Limit as x approaches 0 of sine of x over x. Who knows this limit? Does anyone know what this limit is? It's 1. Limit as x approaches 0 of sine of ax over bx equals a divided by b. So if you have sine of 3x over sine of 5x, or over 5x, you just get 3 over 5. And it's true if you have limit as x approaches 0 of sine of ax over sine of bx, you also get a over b. I can prove these to you later if you would like, but let's just take them without proof now. All right. Using those limits on the right, what is this guy? Limit as x approaches 0 of sine of 2x over 3x, what do I get? 2/3. Wow, that makes life so much easier. By the way, these also work with tangent. It's like an advertisement. Now with tangent.
Not cosine.
Not cosine, no. Okay? So this one, we have tangent of 8x over sine of 4x. So guess what? That would be 8 over 4 or 2. Makes your life easy. And the last one?
Why?
I tricked you guys. It's approaching infinity. Pay close attention here. Those limit tricks I told you only work when x is going towards 0. This is like when I tell you, and I've done this trick with you guys many times, or some of you many times, spell cop. Spell bop. Spell mop. What do you do when you come to a green light? It's a green light. Right? So look, I said limit as x goes to 0. So you guys are like 2/3, great. Limit as x goes to 0, great. 8 over 4, that's 2. Limit as x goes to infinity, oh great, 10. Wrong. Limit as x goes to infinity. In this case, your limit is 0. Here's why. Sine is always between what two numbers?
Negative 1 and 1,
right? So this is basically, you could say sine of, this is a squeeze theorem of sorts, so we're kind of skipping ahead, but this is going to be less than 1 over 10x. But greater than negative 1 over 10x, right? Because after all, sine is between what two numbers? 1 and negative 1. I should say, or equals 2. Now, if I take the limit as x goes to infinity of 1 over 10x, where does this guy go?
0.
So look at the numerator, it's just 1, right? But if I put Bill Gates' amount of dollars in x, I get 1 over a really fucking huge number, right? Which is basically, 1 over a really big number is 0.00000. We might as well just call it what? 0. So we get 0 on the right, 0 on the left. What's the only number that is, you say, might say, squeezed between 0 and 0?
0.
Cool. All right. Great.
I didn't get a marker, did I?
I did.
It's blue.
Are you okay with blue the rest of the review? All right. So, if it's negative, make it positive. It's a pretty simple rule, but not anymore. We got to change things a little bit. If the inside is positive, so let's start with the bottom piece. If the inside is positive, what do you do with the bars?
Drop
them. Just drop the bars. If the inside is positive, just drop the bars. And I'll put a or equals 2 on that guy. If the inside's negative, you drop the bars and put a negative out in front of it. Cool? So with that in mind, let's simplify absolute value of pi minus 2 plus absolute value of pi minus 4 plus absolute value of 6 minus 2 pi. All right? Pi minus 2, is that a positive number or a negative number?
Positive.
Positive. Pi is about 3.14159. Pi minus 2 would be a positive, so we just drop the bars, right? Just drop the bars. Pi minus 4, positive or negative?
Negative.
Negative. So we're going to drop the bars, but we're going to put a negative out in front of it. And what about 6 minus 2 pi? Well, if pi is 3.14159, 2 pi is about 6.28 whatever. 6 minus 6.28 would be something that's negative, so we're going to, again, drop the bars and put a negative in front. And at this point, we play the let's combine a lot of variables, a lot of terms game. I'm going to check on my camera, make sure it's recording okay, that you can see the screen okay. And in the meantime, someone can give me an answer. Oh, we're good. I'm running the camera now. It's kind of weird. Take some pies, cancel. So we get... So basically, this is just this is the rule. Basically, what is something greater than 0? Something greater than 0 is positive, something less than 0 is negative. So basically, this is saying if the inside is positive versus if the inside is negative. Is that what you're asking? Are you asking about this question or this up here? Okay, she's got you. All right, so this simplifies to 4 minus 6 is negative 2. I think I get negative 2 plus 2 pi. But I'll take disagreements if you get something different. Negative 2 plus...
I got 2 pi minus 4.
Wow, okay. Hold on. Let me try this again. Pi is canceled. Negative 2. So I get 2 pi for sure. Negative 2 plus 4 is 2. Minus 6 is negative 4. 2 pi minus 4.
Yes.
But what? Did you distribute the negative through?
Negative to the... Yeah. But doesn't that make that...
Yep. Plus 4. Negative 2 plus 4 is 2. Minus 6...
Oh,
geez. So 2 pi minus 4. Let's try one more. And again, this is what the exam tip at the bottom is telling you. Here's how you read the new rule. If the inside is positive, drop the bars. If the inside is negative, drop the bars and put a negative in front. All right, we have 8 minus c, where c is a value between 3 and 5. You can use any value you want to. You can even use 4. That might make things easy. So figure out a number between 3 and 5. Let's do 4. 8 minus 4, is that going to be positive or negative? Positive, so we just drop the bars. 2 times 4 is 8 minus 3 is 5, which is positive. So once again, we just drop the bars. C minus 6, because C is the number of the value we chose for C was 4, C minus 6 will be negative, so we drop the bars and put a negative out in front. Oh, hey, man. I'm surprised you. Oh, grab a packet. Okay, the C's cancel. 8 minus 3 is 5. Minus negative 6 is 11. So I got an answer of 11. Good? All right. Next page. Any questions on this page? All right, keep it going. Keep the dream alive. Absolute value with limits. Limit as x approaches 2 from the right. So once again, we're approaching 2 from the right. That's a number slightly larger than 2. We're going to think, what happens when I plug in a number slightly larger than 2?
Negative.
2, like 2.1. When I plug it in, 2.1 minus 2 is what? Positive or negative?
Positive.
Positive. So guess what? What happens when the inside of the absolute value is positive? You just do what with the bars?
Drop them.
So we're going to have x minus 2 over, and I'm going to have x plus 4 times x minus 2, limit as x goes to 2. And now I'm going to cancel the x minus 2s, leaving me with limit as x approaches 2 of 1 over x plus 4, giving me 1/6. That's my answer. Okay. What if the limit as x approaches 2 from the left? In this case, we're plugging in a number slightly less than 2. So I'll be like what? 1.9 minus 2 is going to be positive or negative? And because the inside of our absolute value bars is negative, we drop the bars, but put a negative out in front. Once again, my denominator factors into x minus 2 times x plus 4, this time with a negative on the x minus 2 out in front of the numerator. Still limit as x goes to 2 from the left. Well, guess what? Once again, I've canceled the x minus 2s, but this time I'm left with a negative up in my numerator. So my answer this time isn't 1/6, it's going to be negative 1/6. Good. All right. I want to dispel any sort of thought process that might think, oh, if I approach from the right because I see a positive, it must mean that I'm just going to always have a positive. That's not going to be the case. Look, limit as x approaches 3 from the right, but look what happens. When I pick a number slightly larger than 3, like 3.1, and I double it, I get 6.2. 6 minus 6.2 is going to be what kind of number on the inside? A negative. So don't think that because you're approaching from the right where you see a nice little happy superscript of a positive, that you're always going to get a positive on the inside of your absolute value. Once again, something slightly larger than 3 would be 3.1. 2 times 3.1 is 6.2. 6 minus 6.2 is negative. So even though we're approaching from the right where we see a nice happy positive, we actually get a negative on the inside of our absolute value bar. So we end up with when we drop the bars, we put a negative out in front over something that factors into x minus 3 times x plus 3. Limit as x approaches 3 from the right. I'm going to say this factors as negative 2 times x minus 3 over x minus 3 times x plus 3. Basically, that's how that factors. I'm kind of glossing over the factoring part because I assume you know how to do that. Is that too big a leap of faith? Okay. Some people are like, yes, I don't know how to factor. X minus 3 is cancel. Limit as x approaches 3 of 2 over x plus 3. Now I can just safely plug in 3. That gives me 2 over 6 or 1/3. I want some Sour Patch Kids. No, that's fine. I've got plenty of candy up here. Speaking of candy, does anyone need any? Anyone? Pop? Orange or green?
Green.
Can I have a red? Red knockoff Starburst. Starburst, caramel? Anything is what?
Anything is fine.
Oh, anything is fine. Caramel?
Green pop.
Caramel? Caramel? Starburst. Knockoff Starburst. Two coming. Let's basically split fire. Anything. Here, take two. That's all right. We're going to leave it in there. They're going to find it on Monday. They're going to eat it. Anyone? Okay. All right. Let's recenter. Let's focus. Let's center our chi here. Okay, so we have a limit as x approaches 0 from the left of x times the square root of 1 plus 4 over x squared. Yeah, this is actually a really hard one. I actually recommend starting this one, coming back to it, because this is difficult. I'm going to start by getting a common denominator on the inside of my radical. And again, you might not know to have done that to start, but, you know, tinkering with it is just always one of the best things to do. Just tinker with the limit and see if you can get something to happen. I basically got a common denominator out there. I'm going to actually get a different pen because this is actually really important. We have the square root of x squared. Basically, there's an x squared in the denominator, right? What's the square root of x squared?
X.
You think it's x.
What? Everything is
plus
minus.
Oh, no, it could be plus minus. Because you're getting a positive
identity. It's so hard.
But the square root of x squared is actually absolute value of x. So I'm actually going to write that on the page in red. That's why I went to fetch this other marker, because it's super important. Let me write this down. So, square root of x squared is absolute value of x. Put a cloud around that. Draw a unicorn or a puppy dog or something, or a rainbow. But you got to remember that one. Square root of x squared is actually equal to the absolute value of x. So I'm going to write this as equals limit as x approaches 0 from the left of x over absolute value of x times the square root of x squared plus 4. I basically took this guy and pulled him out. I can only pull out an x squared through a radical, though, if I rename it what? Absolute value of x. Okay? That's hugely important. Hugely, hugely important.
How do we just pull that out here?
Well, what's the square root of x squared?
Absolute value of x.
Absolute value of x. So I'm going to take that. It's in the bottom, so it stays in the bottom on the outside. Right? If I ask you, say, what's the square root of 1/4? You would tell me what? What's the square root of 1? 1. What's the square root of 4? 2. So I'd have 1 over 2. I can do that. I can square the top, I can square the bottom. I'm going to leave the top in the square root, but I'm going to take the square root of the bottom, which is absolute value of x.
Oh, so then why is it x over absolute?
There's already an x out here, right? You remember that?
Oh.
That guy's still here.
Okay.
Hi.
Sorry. Okay.
Don't forget about me. Okay. Limit as x approaches 0 from the left. Well, as with any limit, you plug in 0 over 0 gives you, or you plug in 0, you get 0 over 0. So, what is the absolute value of x when x is less than, well, pick a favorite number slightly less than 0, like?
0.1.
Negative 0.1. You said 0.1. You meant less than 0, so negative 0.1. When I plug in negative 0.1 into x here, do I get a positive or negative inside my absolute value? No, no.
Oh, inside.
On the inside. Do I have a positive or negative on the inside? I have a negative on the inside, so what do I do? I draw out the bars and put a negative out in front.
And that's because the limit's approaching 0 from the left.
Right. Well, limit's approaching 0 from the left means we plug in a number slightly less than 0, like negative 0.1. When I plug that in, I get a negative on the inside of my absolute value. What happens when the inside of your absolute value is negative? You drop the bars and put a negative out in front. That's what I did there. Well, at this point, I can cancel the x's. Limit as x approaches 0 from the left of negative square root of x squared plus 4. Now let's plug in. What's 0 squared? 0 plus 4 is 4. Square root of 4 is 2, so my answer is negative 2. Super, 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 super tricky because of that square root of x squared. A lot of people want to say the square root of x squared is just what? They want to see it's just x, but it's really absolute value of x. Yeah?
Why couldn't you take the square root of x squared? I think it's because it's a plus.
Yes, exactly right. Remember we talked about this earlier, the square root of x squared, or maybe you weren't here, but the square root of x squared plus 4 is not equal to x plus 2. Can only, yeah, you're exactly right, because there's a plus there, it will not distribute. Limits to infinity and beyond. Limit as x approaches infinity of 3 e to the negative x plus e to the x over 2 e to the negative x plus 3 e to the x. Okay, for this one, here's the deal. Let's think about what the graph of e to the x looks like. If your exponent on x is very positive, where does this go? To infinity, right? If the exponent on this guy is very negative, where does the e to the x go?
Negative.
To 0, not to negative infinity. I'm talking about the y value. So it goes. The y value goes to 0. So here's what's going to happen. I'm just going to, let's see what happens if I plug in. This is not technically a legal move, but it's going to help you understand the behavior of what's going on here. 3 e to the negative infinity plus e to the infinity over 2 e to the negative infinity plus 3 e to the infinity. Now, like I said before, you can't really plug these in, but it's going to give you an idea of what's happening to these functions. What is e to the negative infinity? What happens is x. What happens when the exponent of an exponential like e becomes really, really negative? It goes where?
Zero.
To 0, right? Look at the graph. As x goes to the left, what happens to the y value? It gets closer and closer and closer and closer to 0. So we get 0 and 0 there. Say 0 and 0. But then I'm left with what? I'd basically be left with e to the, you could say e to the x over 3 e to the x, because I know that the, I know that those other pieces are going to 0. So I'm looking at just e to the x over 3 e to the x. But what's e to the x over 3 e to the x? Just 1/3. Okay, now let's play that game in the other direction. What happens if I send x toward negative infinity? Well, in this case, who's going to go to 0? Which of these pieces, I mean to say? So which of these pieces, if x goes toward negative infinity, which of those pieces goes to 0? A, B, C, or D? Or multiple of them? B and D will both go to 0 as x goes to negative infinity. These guys are now taking on that huge negative exponent, so they automatically go to 0. And I'm left with 3 e to the negative x over 2 e to the negative x, limit as x goes to negative infinity. But at this point, we can do what with those e to the negative x's?
Cancel them out.
Cancel them out, and I'm left with what? Yeah. Same reason that these guys give a 0 over here. When the exponent on e is very, very negative, like negative infinity, e to the negative infinity goes to 0. So that's why, do you understand why these went to 0?
No, that's not
okay, both this and these, right?
Mm-hmm.
Look at the graph. As x goes to the far left, where does the y value go?
Oh, towards 0.
Towards 0, right?
Mm-hmm.
All right, good. This is another tricky one. For our purposes, I'm going to use what I like to call the Bill Gates rule. The Bill Gates rule says if you had 9 times 1 trillion squared dollars, would you mind if you lost $2? No, you wouldn't mind too much. So for our purposes, and this works for the most part, works out pretty well in cases like this. This would be the same as just like saying, you know what, the 2x is not going to matter diddly squat compared to something that's as big and buff as 9x squared. And then we have over, same thing. If you had four times the amount of Bill Gates' money, would you care if you dropped the plus $1? No. So we consider it negligible. So now I just have square root of 9x squared over 4x. What's the square root of 9x squared? I thought we just talked about this. Yeah, absolute value. Remember? 3 absolute value of x. The square root of x squared is absolute value of x. Do not forget that. So once again, write it here if you need to. Square root of x squared equals absolute value of x. Okay? This is important because if you don't have that absolute value, you take the limit as x goes to negative infinity, you just get 3/4. But because x is going toward negative infinity, we're plugging in negative on the inside of the absolute value of x. Because we're plugging in a negative into our absolute value, what do we do with the bars? Drop them and put a negative out in front. Because we're plugging in a negative number into our absolute value, we have to drop the bars and put a negative out in front. But now what's my answer? -3/4. You see how if you don't drop those, if you don't drop the bars with the negative in front, or you forget to put the bars there altogether, your answer would have been 3/4 and you'd be wrong. Cool? This one. Whenever you see this one, which is kind of an innocent looking square root all by itself, you want to multiply by conjugate over conjugate, even though you don't really see a fraction. What you're going to do is you're going to say over 1 to get things started. You're like, you know what? I don't care. There's not a fraction. I'm going to make a fraction to show up there. So I'm going to multiply the top and the bottom by square root of 4x squared minus 4x plus 2x. Notice that when I have a difference of squares like this and I FOIL everything out, first term becomes 4x squared minus 4x squared, all over square root of 4x squared minus 4x plus 2x. So that I'm just left with negative 4x over. Now are we still good? I guess there's a little some mood lighting up there that helps. Okay. I'm just worried about what happens when the sun goes down. Vampires and whatnot. Okay. Now, what your professor might do or what you might have seen your professor do is this little magical thing where they multiply on the top and the bottom by 1 over x. That's helpful. I'm also going to use the Bill Gates rule, which says you have negative 4x over, this would be approximately equal to, square root of 4x squared plus 2x. You're not going to miss 4x dollars if you have 4x squared dollars, if x is getting really, really, really big.
So with the other thing that the teachers were doing is they divide by the common, like the highest.
They divide by x. Yep. So you could say one. Okay. Yeah. So you could do that as well. Multiplying the top and the bottom by 1/x over 1/x, and that would give you -4 over square root of 4 minus 4/x plus 2. So what I did there is multiply the top by 1/x. That gives me -4. I multiply the bottom by 1/x. 1/x times 2 is, or sorry, 1/x times 2x is just 2. When I take an x but move it into a square root, it has to put on a hat. It has to put on the squared hat, right? See what I'm saying? When an x goes inside a square root, you have to put a squared on top of it in order for it to move in. So by doing so, you get 4x squared over x squared gives me 4. -4x over x squared gives me 4/x. And from there, you can take the limit as x goes to infinity. This would give you... Oh, let's put it this way. Where does 4 over x go when x goes to infinity? 0. When x gets really, 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 really big, 4 over x gets really, 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 really small. It goes to 0. So it's just going to give me -4 over square root of 4 plus 2, which is, I know I deviated from my original plan, but this also works, -1. Well, you also could have done it over here where I used the Bill Gates rule. I said you could have just said, you know what? That -4x is going to make too much diddly squat of a difference. So this gives me -4x over 2 absolute value of x plus 2x. Remember, square root of 4x squared is absolute value of x. But because x is positive, we can just drop the bars. So we get -4x over, oops, wait, what? Oh, yeah, we're good. Over 4x equals -1. All right. This is going to be a try at home, but you're going to do the limit as x goes to infinity. I'll tell you what the answer is. Think of it this way. What do I have at the top? Just a plain old little bitty, itty-bitty what? 3. I'm sending x toward infinity, so I get e to the infinity in the bottom. You basically have a water pistol compared to a tank on the bottom. Water pistol on the top, tank on the bottom. Who wins?
Tank.
So this goes to 0 because the denominator dominates the numerator. 3, a little bitty 3, versus e to the infinity. It's going to be a really, really big number on the bottom. Puny number on top divided by a huge number on the bottom gives you 0. We're not quite done yet because a horizontal asymptote means you find the limit as x goes to infinity and the limit as x goes toward negative infinity. But we talked a minute ago about what happens when you send the exponent of e to negative infinity. Where does it go? Let me slow that back down. I'm sending x toward negative infinity. Where does the e to the x go if x goes toward negative infinity? 0. So I get 3 over 0 minus 2, or negative 3 halves. Good? Any questions? With that in mind, I think we're on continuity now. Please? Please, God. No. Squeeze theorem. Okay, that's all right. That's all right, we can get this out. All right, so here's the squeeze theorem. Fact, function, limit, answer. All right, you start with a fact, something like this. We have this scary limit. We say, you know what fact we know? That sine of no matter what you have is always between 1 and negative 1. So that's our fact. Okay? Step 2, you want function. Function is what you have on the left. We want that x squared sine of 4 over x cubed to look like this in here. How do I do that? What do I need to multiply both sides of this inequality by? X squared. So I'm going to multiply by x squared. That's going to give me negative x squared less than or equal to x squared sine of 4 over x cubed less than or equal to x squared. That's function. So we have fact function. We have our desired function in the middle now, don't we? Take the limit as x goes to 0 of the whole thing. What's the limit as x goes to 0 on the left piece? What's 0? What's the limit as x goes to 0 of negative x squared? 0. What's the limit as x goes to 0 of just x squared? 0. So we took in our limit, and guess what? The limit in the middle must go to where? Must go to 0. So this limit is 0. Now, here's a common question I get. I'll get your question in a second. Is the squeeze theorem always going to give me an answer of 0? The answer is no, and we'll see that in next question. Yeah?
I don't think you can get negative x squared and x squared. So don't you have to divide negative
1 by? No. Look what I have here. I have sine of 4 over x cubed. What do I want this to look like? I want this to look like this guy. So what should I multiply this by? What do I multiply this guy by to get to x squared sine of 4 over x cubed? I multiply both sides by x squared. Make sense? Okay, once again, let's start. We have a squeeze theorem limit. Start by, and by the way, what's a dead giveaway? This is kind of a squeeze theorem. We see this 1 over x. 1 over x, 1 over x squared, 4 over x cubed on the inside of a sine. So it could be sine or cosine or sine. You know, anytime we see these, sine of 1 over some wacky function, that's sort of an indication that you should be using squeeze theorem. Okay? Now.
Sine or cosine?
Sine or cosine, yeah. Now what do we see here? We see a cosine, right? So we're going to start with cosine of 1 over x. What's our fact? Cosine of 1 over x is always between 1 and negative 1. Okay? Words are so hard sometimes, you know? Yeah. All right, so we want to tinker or finagle with the thing on the inside to make it look like this thing on the left. So what would you do both sides to start?
Multiply by x.
Multiply by x. So I get negative x less than or equal to x cosine of 1 over x less than or equal to 1. Oops, sorry, less than or equal to x, I should say.
Why are we disregarding the e right now?
Because what if I do e to both sides right away? If I do e to both sides right away, now what? Does this look like this just yet?
No.
So how am I going to get an x up there? Could I multiply both sides by x? No, because why not? Because if I do, where is the x going to wind up? Is it going to wind up here or here? It's going to wind up here. Where does the x belong, though? It belongs in the exponent. So I'm doing the pieces in the order they need to be done in order to get the function that I have. I have to start by multiplying both sides by x. Before I do e to both sides, what do I have tacked on to my cosine?
Two.
A plus 2. So I'm going to do plus 2 to both sides. Almost there. Oh, shoot. Forgot the plus 2 in the middle. And now, that I've got taken care of everything that the exponent should look like. Now I'm going to do what? E to all sides, right? Exponentiate.
Exponentiate.
Good. Taught you well. Okay, that was all step two. We had our fact, then we got our function. Took a few steps to get there, right? Now step three, do our limit. Plug in zero. Well, how does x goes to zero over here? Negative zero plus two is two, so I get what on the left? E squared. How about on the right? What do I get? Same thing, e squared. So guess what I get in the middle? This limit goes to e squared. So this is my answer. Good? All right. This is the page I wanted to take a break. But if you guys are feeling it, we can keep trucking.